Okay, hi, my name is Ian Hewlett. I work in the Social Media Research Lab, which is attached to the Telecommunications Department in this college. And we were initially created as a partnership with a private company called Engage Networks, also provides a CMS, but we branch out in other areas as well. So I'm here to talk about Drupal. There's probably a lot of you that already know something about Drupal, and I'm not going to pretend like I'm an expert, but I'm not a neophyte either. So I did a rather high-level thing. If we want to go into some more details, we can do so afterwards. So a quick background over Drupal, where did its crazy name? Like all sorts of crazy things that came from Europe. It was started by a man who actually finished his PhD in 2008. He started it in 2001. I think you pronounce his name Dries. He's Flemish. So, and it's the actual word came from the word for a drop in Dutch, Drupal. He misspelled dorp and did drop.org when he first started, and dorp would be a village, like a dorf in German. And he misspelled his drop, so that's where it all came from. That's why it has a crazy name. It doesn't actually mean anything. There's two major extensions off of Drupal. Drupal, very similar to all of the other open source, has a sort of foundation that takes control of the code and the actual CMS. But there's some for-profit extensions. Acquia was actually started by the founder of Drupal, so he actually runs that company. And they provide hosting services, training, and such. They're the official implementers of Drupal. And then there's Lullabot. They do some of the same things, but their emphasis is a bit more on training. And they're highly recommended, and I have an example video that you can view on one of our on our development server. And it's free. It's open source. What's not free, just like the other systems, is the work put into it and people to maintain it and the equipment to host it. What do you need? A LAMP environment, which is Linux, Apache, some sort of database, MySQL, PHP is normal, but it can work on a multitude of things. I've not seen a lot of Windows installations with it. I have a feeling there might be some issues with that. Most of what I've seen is LAMP. It works for a couple different databases. The larger companies are being put on board. It has an abstraction layer so that if you are so inclined, you can develop it yourself if you have a favorite database. But like I said, it's mostly LAMP. It ships with some Apache files. And I've included some links at the end of the presentation are all the links that I use that are useful. Drupal.org will be the major one, and it's pretty self-explanatory. Hosting options, you can do it on your own laptop if you have some sort of WAMP or MAMP, little tiny server on your own equipment. Acquia has official hosting options that range from the low end all the way up to a rather robust offering. And that includes some of when the new versions come out, they're obviously part of the release cycle, so they're pretty well equipped. But then anywhere you can put some sort of Linux server, a web server, you can host it anywhere. You can use AIS's virtualization services. You can put a box over and let ATS take care of it. Liquid web, whatever you want. It just needs to have a LAMP environment. The problem, one thing to know is that if you get a hosting company and you want to do a fresh installation, there is file manipulation that goes on with the basic install. You don't even get past the beginning of the install without creating a directory and copying some files. It doesn't have the same sort of OS integration that Plone had. Actually, it has none. So you have to move around files sometimes. There's a couple different flavors out there besides the normal core thing. Current version is 6.19. Drupal 7, which has increased features, capacity for more semantic-based stuff, more RDFA implementations, is in beta 3. It's rumored to be out in April, but there's been a year ago it was being rumored to come out that year, but it is closing down. Drupal Commons installation is a relatively new installation that was put out there that's geared towards business enterprises, so a social enterprise system. This is a plain vanilla thing, very, very sparse theming, so to allow a company to create its own theme and to make more of its own website as opposed to the blue Drupal sign and all sort of thing that's on the normal installation. Civic CRM is another different type of installation. All of these come from people who've customized Drupal and created it for one or couple of different purposes, and they made it available back to the community. Civic CRM is a customer relationship management tool. It's pretty decent. It was made to run some political party calls and such, so it's rather robust. Harvard's got Open Scholar that they've released, which is very similar to what our own department, TISM, has just done. And they created their the professors' websites, their profiles, where they post their actual data on their departmental presence through this. And they can actually give permissions to their research assistants so that they have a little bit more access to the actual website to do things for them and to use it as a little bit of a project management tool. Open Atrium is an internet project collaboration tool. We tried to use it in the lab. I'm not partial to its graphics, so it takes some designs a bit too fun for me. I don't like fun. I was in the service too long. But it still has organic groups and a lot of group-related things, some of the modules that they do, shouts, they're kind of like tweets, but you could do it within your own group that make project collaboration much more, and asynchronous communication much better. This diagram was taken from the O'Reilly book, and I'll describe those at the end. This is sort of the conceptual layering of Drupal, of where it fits. And as you can see, it fits before like client-side stuff and server-side stuff. The theme system is a bit more involved. You're not going to access CSS quite like you saw with the Plone demonstration. We'll talk about that in a little bit more. There's modules that are actually user community contributed modules, not just official modules. Anybody that's in the community that fits this sort of area of instruction to create a module, so they hook into the actual Drupal system, can create a module to do whatever. That's where a lot of the calendar functionalities come from, Facebook integration, Twitter integration, news aggregation, just about anything you could think of. Somebody's started a module on it, or they will be. And that's the area. So these aren't actually from the Drupal Foundation. These are outside things that meet specifications. Core modules are actually ship with it, so when you download it, the core modules are actually in there. That's part of what Drupal 7 does as well. A lot of these highly downloaded modules that are very robust will be integrated into core. And then it runs off of PHP, would be the programming language that's used, scripting language, really. There's an administrative module. I'll demonstrate this in a bit. For site management, so there's a nice series of menus. There's the ability to create new themes. It's hard, though. It's easier to download themes and modify a theme that has the ability to do it by changing color or something like that. Creating an entirely new theme is a bit of work. It uses a data abstraction layer. That's why there's multiple databases that could be attached to it. Most of these will have some sort of data abstract layer. And that means that there is some Drupal-specific syntax if you're actually writing some sort of code to keep in mind when you're querying the database. It's not going to be just, well, there's no standard SQL, but there should be, but there's not. But there's another layer of Drupal stuff that you need to know. And then you can create modules. So it's based off of this series of hooking in. There's a little bit of learning. I'm still building my first real, fully from the ground up module. And there's some reading you need to do to know what to call that's inside of Drupal. There's always that. User management. Users can be given a role, and a role can be assigned permissions, and you can create these roles. So you can make it pretty relatively granular. It's not that hard to do. And if you combine this with groups, there's a module called Organic Groups, you can start to have some real power. We can view some of the user management in the admin screen. Now, what I've done, and I have the URLs, is for the next week, so up till Tuesday, on our development server upstairs, so it's not very robust. So if I have all these thousands of people watching this right now hit the server, it'll probably crash. But for those of us in the room, at least, it'll be fine. I have a Drupal 6 and a Drupal 7 installation. Just email me for a password or something, and I'll let you play with it. I'll give you a decent role. So in here is the actual, on Drupal 6, the actual administration section. Login, where you can go in and change a multitude of things. You can create new content types, the roles for the users and the user settings. You can get in here. I think there's only one user right now. But I could go in here and add new users and new roles. Drupal 7 has a bit nicer thing. This is actually from a module you could download. These are just core on both these installations, vanilla installations. And this module has now been incorporated into core to make this nice little thing here. So you can do much of the same stuff. It's just it looks slightly different. I just thought I'd put both on since 7 is supposed to be coming out, so hopefully so soon. All right, content types. You can create your own content type. What does that mean? Contents are described as nodes in this system. There are also things called blocks, which are a bit more like advertising things. You don't actually add, users don't add some sort of content to a block. And you can create new content types. The two that ship with it are pages, which are more what I consider not sort of static things about us, things that you don't change that often. And then stories, blog-like things, where you would want maybe in a social network people to post their own thing over and over again. And then those are just the initial two types. You can create other types of content. You can create what they look like, what fields are in it, all sorts of things later on. In most of these modules that are from the community, there's new content types in them. Comments would be a content type. Theme system. It's abstracted through, like, that's sort of that's the theme of Drupal, right? Abstraction. Through the use of the what they call a theme engine, and you can use some of these PHP-related extensions that to change themes. I mean, it's a little bit easier if you actually know one of these things. You don't have to get straight into the CSS, but you can do that as well. There's tons of themes that are regularly contributed that you can download and install, but changing the markup isn't as simple as what we just saw in, it can kind of be as simple as what we saw in Plone. But there's an API for generating and validating process HTML forms that you need to learn first. You're not going to go straight into a page and just change it. So it just doesn't work very well. If you do that, it's going to be wiped as soon as you have some sort of upgrade. And there's patches coming out all the time. And you can automatically, through the admin screen, apply those patches. So that's a common complaint at Drupal is the difficulty with theming. There's a theme or developer module, which is nice when you're going through and trying to figure out a Drupal site from somebody else, or if you put in a lot of community modules and you want to know where this sort of theming is from some other thing that you downloaded, it can show you in another window exactly what is being applied to this element on your page that helps you sort through this. And although this isn't fully related to just theming, Drupal does utilize jQuery, which has caused some bugs sometimes as well. Community modules. So Drupal has a pretty extensive user community, and there's a lot of activities that you can do. I went to a Drupal camp in Chicago with a couple other people, a couple students, this last June. There's a big DrupalCon, big convention going on in Chicago in March. Chicago's the closest one, but it happens all over the place. There's a European Drupal convention. I think last year's was in San Francisco for the North America. And online, there's tons of stuff going on for Drupal. They have a very robust community. It's one of the strong points. Like I said before, there's tons of modules. You can see some of them here. I just did the events, the ones that are on events. There's calendars, birthday things you can do, different types of views, agendas, anything. And this is just over the topic called events. Tons and tons and tons of modules. And there's a local group that's on the Drupal site. There's a few groups that are trying to start here. I know some people upstairs that are interested in starting a group that meets somewhere here in a regular meeting. But the one that's actually on Drupal.org is the URL is located there. And I've not actually gone to it yet. I've been a little too overworked, but hopefully. So some of the similar suspects, usual suspects, because just like us, there's no standard for any university, it seems, for a content management system. So some of the same ones that are using Plone are using this. Penn State has a college using it. Harvard did an actual release for Open Scholar. The White House is using it, as mentioned before. One of the larger and more highly trafficked sites that I thought was interesting was the South African government's, their FIFA 2010 site. It was, the White House gets a lot of hits too, but I thought that was interesting. And there's actually links for more of these sites. Drupal's very, very big on promoting itself. That's why people know about it. So they're they're loud and proud. And they actually have the founder actually keeps a cases thing going on. There's a lot of big names here, like Best Buy and stuff. Read a little bit further. It's often a segment of a large company. It's not always like the entire company's presence, but it's still impressive. It's not the second coming, though. And if you go to a Drupal camp, if you listen to somebody who's very active in the Drupal community, they're going to tell you it's the second coming. This is it, right? This is the big one, and everything's going to be perfect using Drupal. Well, that's not true. It's a flexible system with the modules. It's quite nice the way that they've designed to hook in. Like I said, everything's abstracted, which is a benefit and a drawback. It's extensible. It's innate SEO. It has to do mostly with like titles and such. Role-based permissions, and it's pretty easy to publish on it. It's not like WordPress for just blogs, but it would probably be pretty easy to run a blog off of it. And Dries runs his blog off of it. It's not that hard. It's because you start with the type of content types that just ship with it or privy for a blog or a news type site. And then really large supporting community. Drawbacks, you need to know stuff. That's a problem because you need to know specific stuff. And there's a lot of layers. That's a complaint and or a worry of speed. There's tons of optimization techniques that people have out there, and for sites that we're running in our projects where we don't have that many active users, there are very specific sites, 500 users, that's fine. But what happens when you're FIFA 2010 or such, you need to start doing some optimization and such that's different, that's not just out of the box. It takes careful planning to customize anything because you don't want it erased when you did an update. And their motto is override, don't change. So they have this sort of quasi-OO idea, object-oriented idea of extending something and building on top of it rather than changing it and forcing a change over top of it. But that takes a long time. And then, in my opinion, a drawback is the PHP language. Plones and frameworks like Django have an advantage by using an object-oriented language like Python, which can use extensions from other languages, which is how you can hook into your Novell or something like that. You can use Java classes or you can use .NET classes later on. You can't do that with PHP very well. It wants to be. I think classes are coming out with the next version of PHP, but it's not there. It's a sort of a hacky scripting language, and Drupal's done a really good job pushing it as far as it can go and making it OO-like, but it's not. Best places to go to learn more. Drupal.org is the best place. Lullabot's got some decent stuff on there, but you got to pay for some of it, unless your department's already paid for it. DrupalCon. Going there, there's tons of stuff. They have different little stickers for what your level is, and everybody's really friendly. They won't serve you Kool-Aid, so don't worry about that. They're not quite like that, but they definitely are very active. And if you're brand new, you'll be on the right track. Most of the talks and such have a different track, and you can learn a lot. There's also regional Drupal camps. Those are like mini things. They're a couple days long. And then there's some good books. The two that I like the best is the O'Reilly book. This is actually written by a lot of the people that do the Lullabot videos. And you need to kind of know something about Drupal before this. After the first chapter, you'd be lost. But it has something to do with what you do with all these modules and all the stuff that's going on, how you can actually use them. And this one's a bit more hardcore if you want to start doing modular development, more theming. There's some specific books about theming. I'd recommend that if that's what you're into. I'm more of on the development side, so I like to build a module to do something cool with semantic information. If you want to get a hold of me or Becky Roth, who's actually I'm going to be in charge of the lab soon and doing some of the projects that we're on. You can give us a call. We're upstairs in 249. Give me an email. And then here's a consolidation of the links in different areas that were throughout the presentation. I recommend going perusing most of those. And like I said, if you want to play with it, I'll watch the video, that last link down there. It's a bit small, but there's an actual, I put one of Lullabot's videos on there. We bought them. We should be able to do it in an educational environment, hopefully. But I'm only leaving it up till Tuesday. And then same thing with the 6 and 7 installation. It'll be open up until Tuesday if you want to take a look at it. And now, I think that if there's any questions,